it now after seeing this. Outside the chicken sheds, the charmingly named dead bins.
I've got to show you inside this dead bin in a minute. I've just looked in here and you're not going to believe what's inside it.
I mean, this is utterly, utterly repulsive. Look, it's crawling with maggots, and you can't tell me this is following guidelines.
No, of course, what they're supposed to do is to get rid of these birds, take them away from the place where they might be passing on infection to the living birds.
How long is it before maggots appear when something's thrown in?
Probably 4 or 5 days.
So those have been in there for 4 or 5 days. Where should they be? Surely it shouldn't be allowed to get to that.
They could be put into a freezer, or they could be taken to a proper disposal place. You can actually tell how long exactly they've been there by looking at the developmental stage of those maggots.
And is that not grounds for prosecution?
Not for the welfare of those birds, but it would contravene the codes of practice not to take these birds away, because it would put the other birds at risk.
But, I mean, the smell must be appalling. Dead bins like this are a frightening example of how bad things can get. But according to Professor Broom, the conditions inside these sheds are anything but rare.
Well, what we're seeing here is a chicken production unit which is not atypical. Most of the birds are walking around, a few of them are severely affected. This isn't very different from what happens in other chicken production units.
So this is the reality of the chickens that we see on our supermarket shelves?
Yes, it is. Yes, these are the conditions in which the birds live.
Ironically, on the office wall, an out-of-date certificate shows that 4 years ago, this farm satisfied the requirements of the assured chicken production standards for chicken for human consumption. So who's responsible for these appalling conditions? Alongside that certificate are a number of documents showing that this farm supplies chickens to Grampian Country Foods. Their chickens are on the shelves of all Britain's big four supermarkets. We asked Grampian if they were aware of these conditions and what they were doing about it.
Grampian Country Food Group takes the welfare of its chicken flocks very seriously. All of our farms are independently audited by Assured Chicken Production to ensure that they meet all the current regulations and legislation covering chicken welfare. We are confident that our welfare policies and procedures continue to be in place on the farm in question and cannot make any further comment on the allegations being made without viewing the footage.
You would hope that conditions like these are rare, but Professor Broom says that the state of the birds here is symptomatic of more widespread problems.
What we've done in breeding chickens for meat production over the last 30 or 40 years is to cause them to develop faster and faster. So birds actually are reaching a weight of 2 kilograms in 35 to 40 days now, whereas 30 years ago it would have been 75 to 80 days. Therefore the leg development hasn't kept pace with the body development. So we have a situation where a bird has legs of a 5-week-old bird and essentially the body of a 12 or 15-week-old bird, and they can't support that body very well. And the consequence of it is that you have damage to the tissue, which means there's pain in the joints, and overall the bird is not able to stand up and walk around as it needs to do.
Back in his kitchen, Raymond Blanc is ideally qualified to perform a chicken autopsy.
To me, this chicken represents, if we can call it a chicken, represents all the ills of the food chains. How can you buy a £2.15 chicken? That chicken has the worst possible life. Look at that, it's totally unnatural to have that kind of thickness of breast. I don't want to touch it. I have to touch it today, but okay, let's take it out of his misery, poor little beast. I want to show you a few things, okay? Look at that. See, all the bone is very spongy. There's no calcium whatsoever. Of course, because that chicken has been grown between 40 150 days. That chicken, 120 days. Okay? Look how thick the legs are. Why? Because that chicken has never run in his life. It was poor little chap, okay? Fed, so it goes as fast as possible and as big as possible. Never mind the taste, never mind the texture, because it's an irrelevance. Okay, so you can see here, look the difference. Okay, all that is spongy, full of blood. Okay, the bone is very brittle. Okay, you can see it here. It breaks very quickly, very brittle. Look at that. Okay, it's not bone. Okay, it is sponge. Okay, so and that one. Okay, so look at the structure of that bone. Okay, look how opaque it is, how healthy it is, how strong it is. But of course that chicken has run, had lots of sex, lots of food from the ground, okay, had a very happy life. So obviously it's a very different chicken, and of course that will translate into the flavor as well. Look at that. Although the chicken, look at the color of that meat. Look at the color. Immediately you can see, okay, the color is so different.
So, want to make sure you don't buy one of those chickens that can't support their own weight? Well, I've got a clue for you, one that we can all look out for in the supermarket. Something that tells us about the conditions in which a chicken has been reared. It's called a hock burn.
A hock burn is a form of dermatitis which affects the layers of skin on a chicken, and it is something which is caused by the ammonia which is in the litter that the birds will be sitting on or crouching on. And ammonia burns skin, and that will affect several layers of skin and may be followed by ulceration. And that would be painful to the chickens because they have pain receptors in the skin, just as we do.
But just how many of these lame, overgrown chickens are making it into the supermarkets?
The study which Nadine Reifman and I carried out in Cambridge involved going to 11 different supermarkets and looking at 384 birds. And what we found was that 82% of the birds had some degree of hock burn, and these levels were rather a lot higher than we'd thought.
Don Broom's study has just been published. It's a shocking indictment of the industry, but it's based on chickens bought some time ago. We wanted to check for ourselves that they were on sale right now in supermarkets. So Professor Broom agreed to go on a hock burn hunt, this time with a secret camera following his movements. Professor Broom went shopping in the Cambridge branch of each of the big four supermarkets. It wasn't long before he found the first chicken with a hock burn, a telltale brown mark on the rounded, scaly part of the leg.
An obvious hock burn there. More on one leg than the other.
And as he continued his buying spree, Professor Broom had no trouble finding them. They were in every supermarket he went to.
The damage to the tissue in with a hock burn of this size would go down several millimetres into the tissue, so that would be quite painful, something like that.
He even found chickens where the hock burn had been carefully removed before the bird was packed.
You can see the hock burn area, even though the scales have been removed there. Mm. You can see that the tissue underneath the scales is damaged by the hock burn.
After several hours of intense shopping, Professor Broom had struck unlucky in all of the big four supermarkets.
On this bird here, this is a fairly severe hock burn, at least for a grade A chicken. Now on this bird you can see that there is a small area of hock burn there, a medium size there, and then there's an area where the scales are missing. There might well have been a more extensive hock burn there. And then on this bird here you can see the tail end, the parson's nose, has a lot of red coloration on it. That area there would be the result of contact.